yesterday we learned how to use SAR to implement a model, a new model, how to analyze the properties of the model, analytical properties, calculate band matrices, RTEs, vertices, and so on. In the end, we concluded with this LaTeX file that was the, you know, the compilation of everything in a very nice format. So today we will move to something slightly different, but also very important and related to SARA, which is how to create input for other codes. Once you have a model implemented in SARA, you see that all this analytical information is obtained automatically. So the idea is to use this analytical information and translate it properly to other tools. For example, we will see how to use this information to run numerical tests with Sphino, also dark matter studies with Micromegas, and collider studies with Macro. And the idea is always the same. We implement the model in SARA, and using some commands that I will show you, we will create the input files for the other codes, so that we don't have to write by hand these input files, which is very lengthy and very prone to error. Okay, so this is the central message. And let's continue with the last part of yesterday's lecture, that was Sphino. We didn't have time. Sphino is the first of these numerical codes that can be used in combination with SAR. So what's Sphino? Okay, well, you saw that SAR is very nice. It provides analytical calculation for many things. That's wonderful. But it's based on Mathematica. And Mathematica, as you probably know already, is not very good when you want to do something numerical. It takes very very long to solve an equation, and also the errors are very large. It's better to use, you know, more dedicated softwares for these numerical studies. For example, if you just want to diagonalize a matrix, in Mathematica you can do it, but it's never going to be as precise as if you do it with Fortran or C++, some algorithms which are well tested and run properly in some libraries and so on. And this is basically the idea. Sphino basically is a numerical code that takes all the analytical information provided by SAR and does numerical calculations with it. So it doesn't do anything that SAR doesn't do analytically. What it does is to do the numerical application, nothing else. And well, you know that, well, originally this code was developed by Werner Faro, but recently in the latest versions, this has been done in collaboration with Florenstau, because they wanted to merge SAR and Sphino in a common framework. That's why they are together. And okay, this is based, I said this already, this is a Fortran code. And Fortran, as you know, it's a very common language for numerical tools in physics. So, and very basic Fortran. It's Fortran 90, but come on, right? Nothing really complicated. You can open the code, read it, and you will understand it for sure. But we are not going to do that. We just want to use it, not to change the code. Okay, and this is what I said already, basically. Sphino is the numerical application of the analytical results of SAR. Okay, so first we will always run SAR, we will implement the model in SAR, and then we will use the results for the numerical application in Sphino. Okay, so let me show you how to do that. Well, you can download Sphino from their website. So you don't have the link, it's in the website of the course. There is a link for Sphino. You can download the latest version. And then you will have something like this. Like this Sphino file that I have here. Okay, this is the latest version of Sphino. So the first thing you have to do is to untar the file. So untar Sphino. Okay, here it is. Okay. So we will have to compile the code, but the code is only compiled after you add the module that has to do with your model. Okay? So now the next thing we have to do is to compile this module for our model, for the scotogenic model we created yesterday. So let me go back to SARA. Okay, here. So again, Mathematica. Today's session, there will be two moments when we have to wait, because we are going to compile these codes and this takes some minutes. And then this is a perfect moment for questions. But we have to wait, unfortunately. But this way you see how this is done. I mean, you don't have to believe me, you can see it. Okay, so we load SARA, we load the model. like we did yesterday, exactly the same. And once this is done, you can, I mean, we can skip all these processes because we don't, we are not interested in analytical results anymore. And we can create a sphere module with this command, make sphere. Very intuitive. Okay. And now we have to wait for a few minutes. So if you have any questions, this is the right moment. This takes, depending on the model, it could take up to hours. But this model, I did it this morning with my laptop, and it takes like 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Not that. But for a complicated model with many particles and so on, it takes time. No questions so far, I guess. Then we have to wait. Okay, what Mathematica is doing right now is to perform some calculations and then output these calculations in Fortran code. You will see that now we are creating code that we will add to the main code of the spinner, and then together we can compile it. Okay, this is the idea. Maybe one thing that I can mention while this is compiling is that, sorry, when this is getting the Sphino code, is that in order to compile, you just need a Fortran compiler. Any compiler is fine. You have a make file in the Sphino folder, and by default, and this is important, I will open it. By default, it assumes that you will use iFort. This is a very common compiler, but you have to pay to get it, or to be a pirate. So most people don't have iFort. I don't have iFort, so I remove iFort and I choose gFortran because this is the one I have. This is up to you. So I have to change it, but if you don't, then no problem. Okay, so I change the make file. Keep running. In my impression, iFort is a little bit better. It usually runs faster. But okay, you have to pay. If you're doing this simultaneously with me, then maybe your laptop is faster than mine and it's finished already. For me, it takes a little. Also, I recommend, this is also important, if you want to get this Sphino code for a very complicated model, don't do it with your laptop, because your laptop will run out of memory very easily. So it's better to use a different computer, and then, I mean, if you hate someone, you can take a piece of the computer, it will collapse immediately. Because internally, what it's doing is making some calculation and everything is saved in the memory until finally it goes in compile. And then, in the meantime, it's getting your laptop very, very slow. Not for this model, but for a very heavy model. Okay, it finished. Okay, so we are done with this file, we can close it. So let's see what happened. Let's go to Sara, to the Sara folder. Okay. Then, output. In output, we have our favorite model, the photogenic. And we have a new folder called Sphino. This wasn't here yesterday. Okay? Then we see that in this folder we have several F90 files. This is the Fortran code. Let me open one for you. There is nothing mysterious here. I don't know. Let's open Calvin's photogenic, for example. It's a very long file, so you don't have to understand everything, but this is just to show that this is just normal Fortran code, nothing mysterious, and it's just many routines to calculate all the couplings in the model. So internally, all the formulas we saw yesterday that we saw them first with Mathematica and then second with this nice LaTeX format, they are written now in Fortran code. Okay, so I don't know. Let me find one for you. Okay. Actually, it's already on file, so. Not so easy to find one that is interesting. I don't know, this one for example. This coupling, which is imaginary eta, Higgs, Higgs plus, eta plus transpose, okay? It's basically lambda 4 divided by 2 minus lambda 5 divided by 2. Okay? So it's written in Fortran. And internally, this routine will be read for every calculation that you want to do numerically. Okay, but this is just to show you that there is nothing really magical in these files. It's just a Fortran code with the analytical results. Okay, so the next thing we have to do is we have to copy all this Fortran code into the Sphino folder. So in the Sphino folder we create a new subfolder called Scotogenic. Okay, now we have it here, Scotogenic, which is now empty. And we will move or copy all these files to that folder, so that we can compile together. This is the idea. So, okay, maybe it's easier if I do this. Okay, you know your folder. I have to find mine. This is in codes. Let's copy it. Okay, I copied already. So, it's not empty anymore. And now, it's the moment to compile. So, it's as simple as make, okay, and then model equal and the name of the model. This is because you can compile as many models as you want, and you will get a binary file for each model, so that you can run a binary file. You can run as many models as you want, and then compile it. So now it's compiling the Fortran code, the central, the core code of the Sphino together with the new routines that have to do with our model. And this is nice because, you know, Sphino contains many numerical routines that have been tested many times, like matrix diagonalization, equation solving. For IP running, for example, they use these Fortran numerical recipes for equation solving. So basically, all those numerical features can be used for any model. You just have to provide the information of your model. And this is the basic idea. Okay, nice compiling. Okay, I forgot to mention one thing. Okay, it's a good moment. While it compiles, let me show you one thing that I forgot to mention. A very important one, actually. Okay, let me go back. Okay, in order to use this Sphino code, you have to tell Sara how to create the code, because there are some options that you can take. So let me show you, because this is something that I forgot to mention and it's actually very important. So you probably remember that in these model files, yesterday we discussed this scotogenic.m, parameters.m, and particle.m. Mm-hmm. Okay, these are the three files that we discussed yesterday. There is another file called Sphino.m that you should write before creating the Sphino code, because this is where you write down the instructions to Sara how to create the Sphino code. So let me show you what we have there. It's actually very simple. Okay, as I said, in this course we are only doing non-supersymmetric models. But you know that in SUSY it's very common to use these universal boundary conditions at very high energies and then you run down, blah blah blah. You can do that with a Sphino as well, and that's what people call a high energy Sphino code. Okay? What we are doing here is a low energy Sphino code, meaning that we only give input values to the parameters at the low energy scale, so at the scale where you define your model. So that's why in the first line we have this only low energy Sphino. True. Okay? This is telling Sara create a code where I don't have to care about this high energy, low energy running, blah blah blah. It's only everything is low energy. Next, you have a list of input values which you have to define. For example, in this model, you remember that in the Lagrangian we had, let me show you again, in the Lagrangian we have these different lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4 and lambda 5 couplings. Also we have this m eta square, this m Higgs square, mn, Yukawa's. In the sphenom.m file you have to tell Sara what are the parameters for which you are going to give input. Okay? And this is what we do here. So here we have a block called minpar, which is like minimal parameters. And you just give some numbers to the parameters and then you define the input, for example, like this. Lambda 1 input, lambda 2 input, lambda 3 input, and so on. And this is m eta squared input. In this block, you only have to provide parameters which are scalar parameters, meaning scalar not meaning parameters in the scalar potential, but numbers, not matrices. Okay? These are numbers. And then, in the next step, let me skip this one. In the next step, which is here, you have to match that input to the parameters of the model. This is super trivial, but you have to do it. So you have to tell Sara that this lambda 1 input that you just defined is the input value for lambda 1. Lambda 2 input will be the input value for lambda 2 and so on. And n eta squared input will be the input value for n eta squared. Okay? You may wonder about what happens with this m Higgs squared. Okay? You know that when you solve the tuple equations of the model, when you minimize, there is one parameter that is solved in terms of the others. So this is what you do here. In this line, you decide what is the parameter that you don't have to input, that is going to be calculated as a function of the others. Okay? And we have decided to use MH squared. Okay? This is also a recommendation. You can choose any parameter here, but it's highly recommended that you use always a square mass term in the scalar potential, because you know that the minimization equations are always linear in this term. So solving the equation is a trivial thing. It's just, you just take the best, you divide, and that's it. If you choose a very complicated parameter that appears cubic in the scalar potential, it may happen that Sara doesn't find an analytical solution for the equation. So it's recommended that if you can, you always choose here a square mass term. Otherwise, you may find some problems. Okay, and finally, we have here these two lines, which is the Yukawa and the Majorana mass for the right-handed neutrinos, which are matrices, they are not numbers. And for them, we have to use this special notation, this syntaxes. Okay? This is telling Sara that for these two guys, which are matrices, there will be also some input. But this is just notation. Okay? Also, and this is also a technicality that I don't want to spend too much time, you have to add these lines. This is also telling Sara that the BEF for the Higgs will be exactly as the BEF for the standard model. The Yukawa for the electrons, for the charged electrons, sorry, will be the same as in the standard model, and so on. This is important because sometimes, for example, if you are working in a two Higgs double model, the Yukawa do not correspond directly to the Yukawa in the standard model, but there is a notation or something, so you have to implement this here. In this case, it's just notation is one to one, so you just have to put there these lines, and that's it. And finally, these two lines is just a list of particles for which you want Sara to calculate, sorry, Sphino, to calculate the decays. Okay? The first line is for the two-body decays, and the second line is for the three-body decays. So here we are saying, please, Sphino, calculate the two-body decays of the upwards, charged electrons, downwards, neutrinos, the Z, the W, the Higgs, the Etas, and the singlets. So basically everyone. So calculate for everyone. You can remove if you want. I'm not interested in the two-body decays of the Higgs. Then you remove it. And that's fine. And in the next line, we have the three-body decays. Usually, three-body decays are only relevant for guys which are very light, because otherwise there is a two-body channel which is open. So typically, people put here only the standard model fermions. But if you have in your model a guy that is going to decay three bodies, you can add it here, and that's it. The reason why you don't do it by default for everyone is that these routines are numerically lengthy. So it takes time every time you run, because you have to do this phase-space integration numerically, blah, blah, blah. So if you think there is a particle in your model that you don't want the three-body decay, don't put it here because you save time. But this is an option. I mean, it depends on your model, your choice, and your physical interest. Okay, so this is the Sphino.m file. You see, very simple. And Sphino probably finished already. Yes, it finished. Okay, so now, if you go to this bin folder, you see that there is a new binary file called Sphino.m. So this binary file corresponds to the one we just compiled. Okay, so now the last thing we need is an input file. I mean, we have the code compiled, but we have to tell Sphino where are the value, the numerical value for our parameters. And if you go to Scrotogenic, you will see that there are some templates that you can use. Here, there are two templates, this LeSchuss and LeSchuss Flow. Okay? But I did this homework for you, so you don't have to use these templates. Actually, in the folder where we have the model files, there is already one, this LeSchuss in Scrotogenic, which is already filled with numbers. So you can use it. I mean, this is in the website. You can use it already. So let me copy this LeSchuss to the folder where Sphino is. It has to be in the same folder. So codes. Codes. Okay. So now we have it here. You see? Let me show you what it has. Okay. So this is basically a LeSchuss format input file. This is LeSchuss is what I told you yesterday, that some people at some point decided to meet and agree on a common format for input and output files. And this is the LeSchuss format. So in the LeSchuss format, the information is divided in blocks, and each block has a very specific meaning. So the first block is model selection. So some options about the model. You don't have to change them. The second block is standard model inputs, so you can modify some parameters in the standard model. For example, you may be interested in running with a different value for the top port match. Okay, I want to change it a little bit to see what happens. You can change it here. This min part is exactly what we just wrote in the Sphino.m. So these are the input values for lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, lambda 4, lambda 5, and n eta squared. Okay? And finally, okay, well, there is this block Sphino input. These are options. Like, for example, I want to calculate branching ratios. One is yes, zero is no. I don't want to calculate branching ratios. Or I want to calculate, I don't know, one loop corrections to the masses. I said no, because I want to run faster. But you can say yes, and then you put one. So there are many options you can change before you run. And below, here, we have the values for these two matrices. So instead of just one number, one flag, here you have to use two flags because these are two indices, no? The 1-1 element, the 1-2 element, and so on. And for you to see, I have this slide where you can see better the values that I have taken. So I have taken these tensor points where these are the values of the parameters that we have to use to run. Nothing else, okay? Right. So, the last thing, we just ran. So this is done just by using this binary file that we have in the bin folder. So bin Sphino Scrotogenic. It ran it and it finished. So typically one point usually takes less than a second. Okay? But for this point it finished. And then there are new files which have been created. In particular, there is this Sphino SPC Scrotogenic file, which is the output. So let's open it and see what we have. Okay. The information is again in this LeSchuss format, so it's divided in blocks. So let's have a look at what we have. So first we have this information about the code we used, about the model, about the input, the gauge couplings at the at different normalization scale. Some value, for example, this is the result of using the tuple equations. I mean, there is a lot of information in this file, obtained numerically. These are the Yukawas that we used. Some of them we didn't have to specify, because these are the Yukawas in the standard model, so they were copied directly. Y up, Y down, Y E, MN. Then again, this is important. This is the block where the masses of the particles are given. So these masses have been computed in now numerically with the code. So for example, you see that the Higgs in this point has a mass of 120 GeV. So this point doesn't work for the Higgs. So we will have to change a little bit one of the lambdas to make it better, but that's okay. And for example, we see that these ETAs have a mass of 430 or 446 GeV. You see that eta R and eta I, which are real and imaginary parts of this neutral light, have a very, very, very similar mass. Actually, in the output, they look exactly the same. And this is because we took a lambda 5 value, which is tiny. And you remember probably that the difference, the mass difference between these two guys is proportional to lambda 5. Because of the smallness of this lambda 5, these two guys are basically degenerate. Then the set boson mass, which is exactly what you expected, the W mass, the masses of the standard model fermions, then the three masses of the neutrinos, which are non-zero. This is because numerically, it's not only three levels, but it also includes one loop corrections to the mass of the neutrinos. And you remember that they were zero at the three level, but they are not zero anymore at the one loop level. So numerically, it was computed. And you can check that they more or less correspond to the correct values by oscillation experiments. And the three masses for the three singlets. Okay? The minus, you don't have to care about it, it's just a CP sign. For fermions, this is okay. But the mass is the positive value, no? the absolute value. Then we have some blocks with the mixing matrices. You remember that we had to define for each set of eigenstates the name of the mixing matrix. So now we have the numerical results for those mixing matrices. So this is SEDX, which is the mixing matrix for the singlets, which is just 1, 1, 1, because we decided to use a diagonal matrix. Then we have this, which is the mixing matrix for the neutrinos, which is, as I said, more or less in agreement with oscillation experiments. You can check if you want. Then we have mixing matrices for down quarks, for up quarks, which combined should give you the CKM, and so on and so forth. Now we have a block called Sphino, which is some information about the code that we don't need to check. And then we have also some flavor observables, which have been computed automatically by Sphino. For example, this flavor kit QFB. If we have time, last day we will discuss this a bit in more detail. But now for the moment, just have a look at the numbers. And basically, these are the results of the numerical calculation for this particular parameter point of these observables. So this is the branching ratio of B to XS gamma, and so on and so forth. Okay? Or for example, if you are interested in lepton field regulation, there is another block, which instead of quark flavor regulation, it's for lepton flavor regulation. For example, mu to E gamma in this point has a branching ratio at the level of 10 to minus 10. So it is excluded experimentally, but okay, this is just for practice, okay? So, and, well, now we have some coefficients for some Wilson coefficient, but we don't have to check this now. And finally, we have the decays. Maybe I should make this a bit smaller. Okay. So now we have the decays. So for those particles we wanted to calculate the decays, the results are here. For example, this is the up2, so this is the charm. So these are three body decays for the charm into different channels, and these are the different branching ratios for this parameter point. So charm, this is the top, which decays mostly 99.8% into bottom and W. Okay. So you have many results here. And also decays of the guys which are new in this model, like this eta R, which is this new scalar, that decays mostly to neutrino and singlet. Basically, neutrino 2 and neutrino 3. Neutrino 1 is very small, just because of the Dukakwa we chose. And that's it. And with this, we conclude the Sphino part. So you saw it's basically the same thing we did with Sara. Analytically, now we did it numerically with the Sphino. We provide some input values, we run the code, and we get the result. And that's it. And you can change the parameter, you get different results, and that's it. Questions about Sphino? Yes.
So, as you said that here the expression of this smallest Higgs mass is simple, it's just lambda times V squared. So if you like get a different result for Higgs mass that is not 125 G, then you can fix, you go back to a lambda and put
exactly.
A lambda. Exactly.
Do you want to check it?
No.
I believe.
Yeah, yes. That's fine.
So if there are like complicated models where this slightest Higgs is not a function of just a single lambda, but a mess of lambdas, then is it possible to code it in such a way so that you give the masses and it calculates the lambdas?
That's your particular job. It's Fino doesn't do it for you. It just reads the values of the parameters and then calculates. So you need to do the work by yourself.
Yeah, so
and then
you
find a way to fix the parameters.
Suppose you go to this 2D-interpret model, for example, then in general, if you suppose the doublets become pairs, then
yes,
this the mass is complicated. Then, how do you decide that it is going to spill out 125G?
You have to make a choice, for example. You say, I will fix all these parameters, and then I will take this one and run it in some range until I find the correct value that I need. I mean, this is just the numerical work that you have to do. But Fino doesn't do it for you.
So it's messing up.
I mean, you have to fit the masses by yourself. Also, the Yukawas, I mean, these values that I put here, these are not by chance. These are values that I computed myself, because that way I know I would reproduce neutrino masses correctly. But nobody told me that. I have to do the calculation by myself.
That is basically my second question.
Yeah.
So, to put the question more precisely, is that when you gave the input of the Yukawa matrix, you gave the input of the full Yukawa matrix, like at the Lagrangian level.
Yes.
My confusion is, how can you do that? I mean, at the Lagrangian level, you do not know. You just know the 10 parameters, like I said. So, it's not like possible to leave Yukawa matrix for the standard model. We just know the 10 parameters, for example, say in the up sector.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what do you mean when you say that I am giving an input for all the elements? I don't understand that.
I mean, for the standard model, we just say this, we use this command here.
Okay, sorry.
But in the sphino.m file.
Yeah, so that YE equals to say YESM.
Exactly, you say, okay, copy the usual standard model values.
So, but the standard model, I mean, you do not know the YESM.
It takes a basis, it makes a choice. It makes a choice. Right. And in that basis, it's well defined. So it takes, okay, for example, for the quarks, it takes the downward quark Yukawas diagonal. And then it corresponds just to the masses, right? And for the up quarks, it's just the CKM times the diagonal version. So in the end it works, but you have to choose and this is done internally.
Okay.
And for the new Yukawas, you have to do the work yourself. So you have to find, by your own means, what are the input values for the Yukawas that you need in order to reproduce whatever you want. You know? Like neutrino masses, or some positive masses, or whatever. These you have to do. Okay, one quick comment, because otherwise we will be late. The idea is that we just run for one single parameter point. So we chose some parameters and we run. Typically, you don't want to run for one parameter point. You want to do a scan. You know, like, okay, I want a million points and see what happens if I get a cloud of points like this or like that. Of course, you don't do it like this. No? Like, you change the number and this, because otherwise it would take ages, no, to finish. For that, either you make your own code in Fortran that is calling this file and changing the value directly, or there is a tool, I think I mentioned the tool in my notes for the course, called SSP. Okay, this tool is was developed also by Florian Stau, and basically it's a mathematical package, very simple mathematical package, where you say, I want to make this type of scan, and then please do it for me. So it just calls from Mathematica, Sphino, as many times as required, changing the values of the parameters. So writes continuously this Lesjus input file, changes the values according to your needs, and then compiles all the output together. I mean, but this is up to you. If you want to do your own code to run scans, this is your choice. I mentioned this, I think, in my notes. I'm not sure. But it's called SSP. So it's SAR scans and something. Okay, so we conclude with Sphino, and we conclude then with what I call lecture one. That it's kind of a bit long, in my opinion. Okay, so let's continue with lecture two. So it's here. Okay, lecture two is about this code called Micromegas. So Micromegas is a very, very famous code for people working in dark matter. I think everyone in the community doing dark matter physics uses this code eventually at some point. It's written in C and Fortran, so it's a bit more complicated to understand. And, well, it's mainly made by these people in France, okay? Actually, there is a missing character here because of the actual problem. You can download it here, and even though in the website I wrote yesterday, please download the latest versions of every code, for this one, I will not use the latest one, because I realized that there is a problem with convention between SARA and Micromega in the latest version. So I will use one which is a bit older, not that much, like 4 months older, which is, I don't remember the number, let me check. It's, okay, this is the version that I'm gonna use. Okay, you can also download it from the website, but it's a bit more difficult to find the link. So to help you, I put the file. I hope they don't care. The author of the code. I put the code in the website for the course, so you can download it directly from the website of the course. Okay. It's opening very quickly, super fast. So you can find it here. So this is the code, Micromega's another version, not the latest one, but it's almost the same. But there is a problem with conventions. That's why I didn't mention. Okay, so this being said, what is the idea? So actually Micromega's is not a code, it's actually a collection of routines. In most cases you will have your own model, but the final calculation that you have to do in order to calculate, for example, the relative density and things like that is the same always. Basically, you have to solve some Boltzmann equations, you have to calculate cross-sections, you have to evaluate also cross-sections with nucleons, evaluate direct detection and things like that. So all these routines are actually model independent. You will have to provide some information about your model so that Micromega knows what are the values for some couplings, basically, and some masses. But in the end, the basic routines are model independent. That's why actually Micromega's is not a code, but a collection of routines. So Micromega's idea is that you write your own code. So you load these libraries, these Micromega's libraries, where all these routines are written, and you basically say, okay, I'm using the routines, I want to calculate this, this, and this. And your code could be 3 lines, maybe. Because the rest is internally written in the libraries, so you don't have to check. However, of course, you have to write the main program, so you have to write a program where these routines are loaded, and also you have to, in this program, you have to provide information about your own model. Okay? And the idea, as I said already today, is to use SARA to do that. In SARA, you have Facebook? In SARA, you will see now, you can create input files for Micromega's, and in addition to the model files, which are here, you also get some examples for programs you can run with Micromega's. And these examples are already very good, because they allow you to calculate, for example, the relative density and things like that. Okay, what can you calculate with Micromega's? So this is basically what you can calculate. You can calculate many things, but most times, you just want to calculate, for example, the dark matter relative density. Okay, this is the most important number in dark matter physics. This omega dark matter square, dark matter h squared, and direct and indirect detection rates. So this is what we are going to do today, to calculate these three things with Micromega. Okay, so let me go to SARA again. Actually, I didn't need to close, but I did. So let's repeat what I did. But now, instead of a Sphino, we are going to create input for Micromega's. So again, we load SARA and we load the model. Okay, this is because I did something. Oh, anyway, I changed the folder. And then it's photogenic. Okay, and in order to create input for Micromega's, you have to use this command, make CHEP. Because the input for Micromega's is the same as the input for Caltech. Maybe some of you know about this other code. So, Caltech. And this is quite fast. Okay, well, not that much, but it's fast. Actually, there is a way to save time, because what it's doing now is to calculate the vertices again. If you save the vertices, you don't have to compute them every time. But okay, it's just a matter of maybe a few seconds. Okay, so now we have created the input files for micromegas in the scotogenic model. Where at this, we go to output as usual, output, scotogenic, electroweak symmetry breaking, and now we have a new folder that just appeared, which is this CHEP. Okay, and we have a few files. This one you can forget, because this is an old version that we are not going to use. There are two CPP files. These are actually these main programs I was telling you about. So these are C++ programs that load the Micromegas library and ask to make some calculations. We will see how to do that later. And then these MDL files, these are the model files. This is where the information about our model is given. So for example, this PRT blah 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 file is, as you can imagine, information about the particles in the model. So some basic information about all the particles we have in the model. And for example, it's interesting to have a look at this Lagrangian that you can read, because this is where the Feynman rules of the model are here. So here we have, for example, let's have a look at this one. This is very simple to understand. This is eta h. Okay, imaginary eta h. You can see already that there are some particles which have a tilde here. These are the particles which are charged under the set to symmetry of the model. Why is that important for Micromegas? The Micromegas is a model to to calculate things related to dark matter. In this model, dark matter is stable because there is a set to symmetry that is preventing the lightest guy from decaying. Okay, so for Micromegas, it's important to know which are the particles which are charged under this symmetry. Because then, immediately, it will check which one is the lightest of these particles and will identify this particle with the dark matter candidate. So this tilde is what identifies the charged particles, charged under the set two. Okay, and in this model, these are the etas and the m, which should be somewhere. Here, m. N1, N2, and N3. Okay, so this is eta i h, so this is the coupling between two etas imaginary and one Higgs. Okay, and it says that the Lorentz part is one, so there is no Lorentz factor here, it's not gamma, mu, nothing, it's just one. And the vertex has to be found in this V0002, and for this we have to go to the funk file where these vertices are defined. So this is a file with definitions of masses and many things, and also vertices, a bit below here. So this is the coupling. This is the definition of the coupling. It's lambda 3 plus lambda 4 minus lambda 5 times the vector, the Higgs vector. Okay, this is the Feynman rule for this particular interaction. That was computed before by Sam. Okay, so how do we use all this information to calculate dark matter stuff? Okay, so first we have to go to Micromegas, open the file and compile it. So to open it, it's just as usual, the typical command. Then we have the new folder here, we go inside and we just make. Okay, this should compile for everyone. If not, have a look at the main file, maybe you are using a different compiler. It should be more or less fast. Okay, next step. It's already compiled, but now we have to create a new project. So we have to use this file here called new project. So we just say new project, and then the name of the project. But it will be something as simple as photogenic. Okay, and this creates a folder with that name, and inside that folder we have many new files ready to put our information. So this is like creating a, you know, a folder where you can work internally without affecting the rest of my projects. This is your project. Now, we have to copy. There is in this folder, there is something called work, and then models, which is now empty. We have to copy all these files we created with Sara inside that folder. Okay? So this is, let me find PT, codes, micromegas, photogenic, port, models. It's a bit long. You can also use copy paste, eh? Like Windows. Okay, here they are. Now, we have to select one of the main programs to run micromegas. As I told you, you can forget about this one because this is for an old version that doesn't work anymore. So we have two versions here, two CPP files. The first one is the simplest possibility, which is I just want to calculate the rel intensity, nothing else. Okay? This is a program that calculates the rel intensity, nothing else. Whereas the second one, in addition to the rel intensity, also calculates direct detection rates. So if you want to compare your model to some experiment looking for dark matter, you will have to use the second one. So let's see how to use both, and then we learn everything. So you have to copy first the one you want to use to the main folder in the project, which is just photogenic. So let's copy, for example, the first one, this calc omega CPP, to the folder, the main folder in the project. Okay, let's go there. Okay, if you want to have a look, no problem. Let's see what this file contains. This is a bit more complicated than Fortran because this is C++. It's a bit more complicated, but if you're used to C++, this should be trivial for you. Basically, this is basically what loads all these libraries in Micromega, and then in the main program, you basically call some routines. In particular here, the main routine that is used is this dark omega, which is the routine that calculates the rel intensity. You don't have to modify anything. It's already done for you, okay? But this is in case you were curious about what you have here. You can modify this. If you are an expert, you can modify some of the parameters that enter the calculation. You can choose, for example, different types of formats for the output. You can modify this. But the point is that you just have to modify this file. And this is very nice. You don't have to use or to mess with the different routines or the different libraries. And this is something that I like in Micromega. And the file is not very long. If you understand what the file is doing, you can modify easily. So let's compile it. To compile, we just do main equal and then the name of the file. Cal omega 50. Compile. Okay. So now we are ready to run. But as usual, you have to provide input values for the parameters. Now we just said this is our model and this is our program. But in order to calculate the rel intensity and so on, you have to provide input values. But for this, we have something very nice, which is that Micromega can take as input the output of Sphino. So we can copy the output file that we produce with Sphino to this folder and then run. And Micromega will read the parameters, the masses, the branching ratios, all the information it needs from this file. So you don't have to write any input file. This is wonderful, in my opinion. I like it very much. I don't like to write files by hand. So, well, okay, it's better if you do it for me. Okay. So we copy. You remember this file was in Sphino, okay, and it was called Sphino SPC Photogenic. Okay, so we copy it here. Here it is, and then we can run. So we just say execute the binary file we just produced, and it's running. The first time you run, it creates some internal files, so it's typically longer. But if you run, for example, for 1,000 points, only the first one is really long. The rest are very, very fast. So that's, now it's computing many things that is saving somewhere else. Okay, well, first, for example, you can see the masses of the particles charged under the Celsius symmetry. And in this particular parameter point, the lightest mass, the lightest particle with a charge under the Celsius 2 is the N1 singlet. because it has a mass of 345 GeV. It's computing, and now in some seconds we will know the answer. What is the relic density at this point? Done. Okay, the relic density is this number here. Okay? Which is basically 1.07. So this is way too large. Cosmology tells us that the relic density is about 10%, so 0.1. So this model would be excluded by dark matter relic density as well. But okay, we are just here to learn how to use the codes, not to discover dark matter. Also, it's very nice that there is some additional information. This number here is the freeze-out temperature. And these numbers here are the different channels that contribute to the cross-section. And the relative width for each channel. So for this particular parameter point, we see that the most relevant channel is annihilation into tau anti-tau. Because this E3 is the tau. Then you have neutrino 2, neutrino 3, neutrino 2, neutrino 2. You have this one, which violates flavor, by the way. For example, this would be neon anti-tau. And so on and so forth. Okay? So this is the way you compute the relic density with micromegas using the input from sun. Very easy. Okay? Any question? No? Then we continue with the next step, which is to calculate as well the direct detection rates. For this, we need to use the other file, which is this calc omega with direct detection CPP. Okay? It's basically the same. I can open it for you if you want. It's basically the same, but before it finished here, basically, it finished here, but now there is some additional lines with the routines, calling the routines that calculate the detection rates. And that's it. Ah, sorry, I forgot to mention that the information is not only displayed on the screen, but it's also saved in a file. This file is this ONG out. Okay, if I open it, you will see. So it's basically the same information we had on the screen, but in a file. So, what we have to do, we just have to compile. But now, instead of this calc omega, we have to compile the other file, the other program. Compile. Now, this is the only comment about physics I will make today. In this model, when the right-handed neutrino is the dark matter particle, the direct detection rates are very, 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 very small. And the reason is that the right-handed neutrino doesn't couple to the quarks. So when it interacts with nucleons, there is no direct coupling between the nucleons and the right-handed neutrino. It only couples at the one loop level, with penguin diagrams like you have a right-handed neutrino, and then something like this, a penguin, for example. No, actually, this should be a scalar. So for example, here you have charged leptons, here you have the eta scalar, and then this guy couples, for example, to the Higgs, and then the Higgs couples to the nucleus. Okay, this is the type of diagram you would need to have a detection rate which is different from zero. In micromegas, these diagrams are not included. So if I just run with that parameter point, I would get zero, exactly. Okay, you can check it if you want. You get zero. So in order to do something a bit more interesting, I will choose a different parameter point where the lightest guy is not the neutrino, but the singlet, but the eta. Because the eta couples, for example, to the Higgs. And then you just have things like this. So, this is the Higgs, and then eta here, and eta here. And then you could have a different from, a result which is different from zero without too much complication. So I have to change the parameter point. Then what do? I go to Sphino, I change the input file, I run again, I copy the output, and I run here, basically. So I go to Sphino, open. So Sphino. I open the input file. And now, for example, one way to make the eta scalars lighter is to change this parameter, which is basically the mass of the eta scalars. So instead of, let me remember, because I have tried some specific values that I'm going to use again. So now the value was 10 to the 5 GB squared. So let's take 5 10 to the 4, okay? Which is a bit lower. I'm changing the parameter point. This is a new parameter point. So I save the file, and then I have to run spin again. Okay, this produces a new Spino file, Spino output. And now if I open the output, you remember there was a block with the masses of the different particles. If I go there, you will see that now the right-handed neutrino with the lowest mass is about 345 GeV, but there is eta. These etas are a bit lighter. So in this parameter point, the lightest guy is no longer the right-handed neutrino, but eta, okay, one of the neutral guys. Important, the neutral guys. If it was the charged one, then it would be in trouble. It would be charged that matter. Okay? So now I copy this file to micromegas and I just have to run. Okay? So CP, I copy the file to micromegas and then to escotogenic. Here. And now I just have to run the second program that we just compiled. Okay? So you see the masses here, the eta I is lower, the mass of the eta I, than the mass of the right-handed neutrino, for example. So this guy is our dark matter candidate for the parameter point.
Avelino, Sara computes the vertices at one loop, right?
Yes.
Why don't you have this diagram?
No, well, but the output for the vertices is only 3 levels.
There is no way to output the whole.
As far as I know, no. Actually, there is something that micromegas can do at the 1 level, but only box diagrams. So if the diagram that you need is a box, then it's fine. But if it is a penguin, then it cannot do.
I guess question was like you can translate this coupling in an effective.
Yes, and compute it with, yes, if you do that, then it's fine, but it's not automatic, it's not done by Sara automatically. Okay, so we have the result. So first, after the calculation, we have again the same values that we had before. We have the freeze-out temperature and the omega h squared, which in this case is really tiny. So again, we would be excluded, but not by too much dark matter, but by too little. And the reason is that these etas have interactions with the gauge boson because they are doublets. So you open many diagrams like this W plus, W minus, something like that. Anyway, this is not relevant for our discussion. And here you have the different amplitudes for the nucleon cross section amplitudes. For example, here, this is given in picobars. So usually, and when you read these plots for dark matter, they are given in centimeter square. So you have to remember the conversion number, which is 10 to the minus 36, I think. So you have to do the conversion. This is picobars. So this would be the spin independent, okay? Just concentrate on these lines. This would be the spin independent cross section on protons and on neutrons, which is really tiny. And you will see now why in a second. And the spin dependent is zero because this is a scalar. Now there is also here, as I said, micromegas also computes these box diagrams. So the next step, this part here, okay, is the calculation including the box diagram, which as you can see, there is very little difference, nothing by eye, with the one without the box. So this is the
reason. Can you just give me a start? I don't know what do you mean by box diagram? Can I draw that out?
Yes. I mean, not that for this model, but in some models you may have something like this, no? The dark matter, something, and then things like this. And these are the quarks, for example. This is a box. So this micromega can compute. But this type of diagram, which is penguin, it cannot.
But this loop is finite, right? Because you don't have the vertex at 3 levels.
Yes.
So then it should be easy for Sara to say this coupling is not zero, it's this one loop vertex I compute.
agree with you.
And then with this, a micro omega should see it as a three-level vertex. Right?
Yeah, yeah, sure. Also, I mean, you can do it by yourself. I mean, you can hack into the code and say, I compute the one loop vertex,
yeah.
And then I copy the result and I put it as an effective vertex yeah. in micro omegas. And then it should work. It's just that it's not automatic. And it's a proposal for an improvement. No?
And there is no way to hard code SAR. I don't know, the output, I don't know how it works, but there is no command to say. Also, the one loop, I want to make it appear in the output.
As far as I know, no. In principle, it's doable.
Yeah.
So, I think it has to do with the fact that the one loop expression would be very long. So, it's a practical problem, maybe. Because you would have to save the analytical expressions for yeah. the, for all. The one loop couplings. And then the file would start growing, and then eventually, maybe compiling this could be numerically a bit bad. I never tried asking for it. Why don't you do that? I don't know. Okay. So, and after the cross sections, it gives you also a different number, which is cross sections times exposure time times the amount of material you have. Gives you the number of events you would expect to expect. So this translation is done for you by micro-omegas. So here you have the different number of events that you would expect in a certain kinematical region per day per kilogram. So in different nuclei. So this is germanium 73, xenon 151, and so on. And the numbers are tiny. And this is of course what you would expect because of these tiny cross sections. So the number of events are tiny, zero, eventually zero. Okay, I was saying, and with this we conclude the session, that there is a reason why this minus 18 appears here. This is because you probably remember when we just saw the list of couplings, that the coupling between eta, eta, and Higgs was something like lambda 3 plus lambda 4 minus lambda 5, something like that. In this particular parameter point, just our choice was that lambda 5 is tiny, so you can forget about it. And lambda 3 and lambda 4 are equal but opposite side. So lambda 3 plus lambda 4 is basically 0. So that's why this coupling is tiny and you expect a tiny cross section. So one simple way to check that this is actually true is let's change one of these couplings and see whether this cross section increases or not. And this we can do. This is just, okay, I don't know, this value for example, 0.1. So lambda 3 plus lambda 4 is no longer 0, it's something different. And then we should expect something much larger for the production, sorry, for the annihilation cross section or the interaction cross section. So we have to run scene again. Okay, we copy the file to the micro-omegas folder. And now we just run micro-omegas again with the new parameter point. The masses have changed a little bit because the masses also depend on lambda 3 and lambda 4. So we have changed the value of lambda 4. And you see that before we had 10 to minus 18, now we have 10 to minus 9. So just changing this parameter to a random value, basically, we get basically 8 orders of magnitude increase. So this is just to show that things make sense. Right? And with this, we conclude the session. I mean, today, as I promised, was shorter. We have seen how to use first Sino to run numerical tests to get the spectrum, the decays, some observables, and then we have seen how to use micro-omegas for dark matter studies to calculate the random density and direct detection rates, for example, and how SAR can help us getting the input for both. Okay. Tomorrow the plan is to do basically the same but with collider studies, so with micro. We will see how to use SAR to get input for mass graphs and then run some collider studies and discover some particles. This is the idea. Questions? Comments? Very easy, right? Okay, tomorrow we have more. And the students, don't forget to come on the side.